بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allow us to reach Laylatul Qadr, the best night of the entire year. And we ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala that He give us the strength and the power that we worship Him the way He deserves to be worshipped, bi-ithnihi ta'ala. My brothers and sisters in Islam, last lesson we shared ayat from Surah Al-A'raf, in which we discussed the discussion and the conversation that happened between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Iblis. After Allah Azza wa Jal commanded the entire inhabitants of the paradise, the angels and Iblis as well, to make a sajda to Adam alayhi salam, they all made a sajda except Iblis. He refused. So a conversation happened between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which we found at the end of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him and He removed him from the paradise. He removed him from the paradise. Now we reach the ayat in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins to speak to us about Adam alayhi salam and what happened between Adam and Iblis. And this is very important for you and I to understand, because this is the very first human being that was ever affected by the evil whispering of a shaitan. So if we know this story really well and we get to understand it really well, then we are at a much better chance to understand the planning and the plotting of a shaitan and how to keep away from his evil whispering and how one is able to protect himself. As Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention the sins of prophets in the Quran to expose them. You know, imagine this, imagine you committed a sin and Allah mentioned it in the Quran. You know, when we commit sins, we try to hide it as best as we can. We don't want anyone to know about it. Imagine this, a prophet of Allah, Adam alayhi salam, he commits a sin, and not only this, Allah would record in the Quran the sin he committed and the result of the sin in terms of his clothes coming off. You and I would think that, you know, how can this be mentioned in the Quran? And imagine that was you committed this sin. You want to erase it from your memory, let alone from the memory of others and being mentioned in the Quran and so on. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said that Allah Azza wa Jal does not mention the sins of prophets in the Quran to expose them. Rather, He does so mankind don't give up hope in the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. That if this is Adam alayhi salam who committed a sin and he was given the chance and the door of tawbah was open for him and he made a tawbah and Allah Azza wa Jal accepted it from him, then how could you and I give up hope in the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, in the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the fact that the story is mentioned, it's for you and I to learn. Adam alayhi salam didn't have a role model before him. So he was the first one to ever interact with the evil whispering of a shaitan. Now at least you and I have his story that we can reflect on and say, okay, now I will take precautions from a shaitan because I know the story of Adam alayhi salam. Anyway, that's a small introduction about these upcoming ayat. However, let's begin first with these ayat where we left off. Allah Azza wa Jal, now He says, وَيَا آدَمُ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ فَكُلَا مِنْ حَيْثُ شِئْتُمَا. So the idea is this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has just expelled Iblis. He's kicked him out of the paradise. He's been removed from the paradise. And now these ayat are telling us how Allah Azza wa Jal is bringing forth Adam alayhi salam. And He's calling him, وَيَا آدَمُ. O Adam. So subhanAllah, it's like someone's been removed and someone is being brought forth. And if anything, this is disturbing a shaitan even more. And this, there's more hatred and more jealousy within the heart of Iblis when he sees this. That he's been removed and this very same creation that he didn't make a sajda to, and he's already filled with jealousy and hatred towards him when he said, I'm better than him. You created him from clay, you created me from fire. Now he's seeing before his own eyes and he knows that Allah Azza wa Jal has brought forth Adam alayhi salam out of honor for Adam. This is Allah's love for Adam alayhi salam. When Allah says to him, وَيَا Adam, Allah is calling, come forth, removed one and brought one, before him. Allah Azza wa Jal calls Adam alayhi salam out of honor and love for Adam alayhi salam, for mankind. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَيَا Adam, O Adam, أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ, reside you and your wife in the paradise. أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ. أُسْكُنْ comes from the word سَكَنْ, and سَكَنْ is a place of like سَكِينَة. It's a place of tranquility and peace and rest. And that's exactly what the paradise is. It's a place of tranquility and rest. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says to him, أُسْكُنْ, come. And the word أُسْكُنْ, it also implies temporary residence. Because a سَكَنْ doesn't mean that you will live there forever. Al-khulud would mean forever. So already from the word uskun, it hints out that Adam alayhi salam will not last forever in the paradise. And he will come out. However, Adam alayhi salam still doesn't know this, and no one in the paradise knows this, other than the angels, who Allah Azza wa Jalla had already told them he's going to create a khalifa on earth. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَيَا Adam uskun أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ, you and your spouse, come and live in the paradise. And this paradise that Allah Azza wa Jal invites Adam alayhi salam to live in is the actual paradise that the believers will end up entering on the Day of Judgment. It's the same paradise. It's not a different paradise, as some opinions might suggest. The most correct opinion on this matter is that Adam alayhi salam and his wife resided in the same paradise that Allah Azza wa Jal promised the believers that they will enter on the Day of Judgment. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَيَا Adam أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ. Now the idea is Allah Azza wa Jalla says to Adam, reside in the paradise. He says to him, you and your wife. لأن العلماء رحمهم الله, they say that a person, when he's in a huge kingdom of goodness and blessings, it will become boring if he's there by himself. So he needs to share this with someone. So Allah Azza wa Jalla gave him Hawa عليها السلام. And there was a marriage, there was this relationship, the first marriage, the first husband and wife relationship that ever happened was in the paradise. This is how noble and this is how honored this relationship is. And if husband and wife in this worldly life were to live upon goodness and upon piety, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deems that relationship so important and honorable that it would also be with you in the paradise. This relationship, it doesn't separate from a believer in this worldly life. If a believer was married and your spouse, you and your spouse were upon goodness and piety, and you're both accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this relationship is so honorable to Allah Azza wa Jal that Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't destroy it. That He allows both of them to enter the paradise. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, أُدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ أَنْتُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُكُمْ تُحْبَرُونَ. Enter the paradise, you and your wives, spouses. And also, in other opinions, it means you and those that are alike you, similar to you in their piety and their iman. So the idea is, وَيَا آدَ مُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكُ, live, reside you and your wife in the paradise. Now, when you're in the paradise, in this huge, vast range of blessing and goodness, what do you want to do? You want to eat now. You want to enjoy the blessings of the paradise. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَكُلَا مِنْ حَيْثُ شِئْتُمَا. Eat and enjoy anything you want in the paradise. SubhanAllah, because this is exactly what the paradise is about. It's about enjoyment. It's about food. And food is the best of enjoyment for not most people, for everyone. Everyone enjoys food. So the first commandment for Adam alayhi salam, before any kind of worship, there is no worship in the paradise, which proves that Adam alayhi salam was in the actual paradise that Allah promises the believers. Allah says to him, when he says to him, come reside in the paradise, you and your wife, he says to him, فَكُلَا. That's the first command. Go and eat whatever you like. مِنْ حَيْثُ شِئْتُمَا. Anything you like here in the paradise, it's all free. You know, Allahu Akbar, all free. All goodness, all coming from Allah Azza wa Jal. There's no rotten fruit. There's no, good and rotten. There's nothing bad. There's nothing off. It's all fresh. It's all in the paradise. Eat whatever you like from anywhere you want. Allah Azza wa Jal, then he says to him, وَلَا تَقْرَبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ. But there is one tree. Do not come near it. SubhanAllah. The ideas that Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned what is halal, before he told them what is haram. And this we need to learn it as a method in a da'wah, that we always give good news to the people before we give them the warnings. First give them the glad tidings. Teach them that the doors of Allah Azza wa Jal are open. The mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal is open. And then you follow it up with a warning. Tell them what Allah Azza wa Jal has warned them of if they continue upon their disbelief or they continue upon their disobedience. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does with Adam alayhi salam, first telling him that everything in the paradise is permissible, go and enjoy whatever you want. And then he says to him, do not come near this tree. Now, how many trees did Allah Azza wa Jal forbid Adam alayhi salam from approaching? It was one tree only. One tree. So how much is halal? 99% is halal and 1% is haram. Allahu Akbar. And this is not only the case with Adam alayhi salam when he was in the paradise at the time, but this is also here on earth when we live on earth. Did you know that the permissibilities, what is halal that Allah Azza wa Jal made halal for us on earth, is way more than al-haram, way more than al-haram. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us and commands us to keep away from al-haram, He says in the Quran, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Do not follow the footsteps of a shaytan. Now, if you had a huge field, and there are footsteps on it, which one occupies more area on the field? The footsteps or the field itself? There is no doubt that the footsteps are going to be something small on the field. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, do not follow the footsteps of Iblis. Do not follow the footsteps of a shaytan. In other words, al-haram is, you count it on your fingers what Allah Azza wa Jalla has made haram for us. It's like you're counting footsteps, footprints on a huge earth. So in other words, Allah Azza wa Jalla pretty much, fundamentally, everything is permissible on earth. And there are a few things that Allah Azza wa Jal made haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions to us what He made haram. Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran, He says, هُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. That He made for you halal everything on earth. Allahu Akbar. And then when it came to what's haram, Allah would count them. For example, in matters of food, Allah would say, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير وما أهل لغير الله به والمنخنقة والموقوذة. And he lists them. The swine, the flesh of the swine, a pig, that's haram to consume. Whatever was slaughtered for other than Allah Azza wa Jal is haram to consume. Whatever was choked of an animal, it's haram to consume and it died as a result. Whatever of the animal was dead, you're not allowed to consume. And there are limited things Allah Azza wa Jal would mention them. And everything other than that is halal. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَأُحِلَّ لَكُمْ مَا وَرَاءَ ذَلِكُمْ. Even when it came to marriage, Allah Azza wa Jalla would say, it's haram to marry your mother, your sister, your daughter, and He lists another 10. And then He says, and after that, all is halal for you. Allahu Akbar. So al-halal is a lot. So what excuse do people have when they fall in al-haram? Allah Azza wa Jalla made beverages, all halal, except al-khamr. Keep away from alcohol. That's it. Why do people fall into something whereas the majority of what Allah Azza wa Jal created was halal for us? And it's only a few things that are haram. Subhanallah, you even look at the case of Ashab al-Sabt, the story of the people of the Sabbath. Allah Azza wa Jal, He made haram for them to fish on a Saturday. One day haram and 6 days of the week halal. That's 68% halal and 14% haram. Subhanallah. So in other words, al-halal is way more than what al-haram that Allah Azza wa Jal made. If you focus on this point, you understand that what kind of excuse does a person have when he falls in al-haram, when he had so many other options that were halal for him. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says to Adam, وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ. Do not come near this tree. Do not approach this tree. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jal did not say to him, do not eat from it. He said to him, do not approach it. And what we learn from this is that the human being is weak. The closer he comes to a sin, the weaker and weaker and weaker he becomes in terms of avoiding falling into this sin. So Allah Azza wa Jal, the one who created us, knows our weakness. So He says to Adam alayhi salam, don't come near this tree. He did not say to him, don't eat from it. He says, don't come near it. Because the fact that you come near it, you are going to become weak. And the closer and closer you get, you're going to become even more and more and more weak until the point where you fall into the sin. And subhanAllah, this is a story for each and every single one of us. When you fell into the sin, how did you fall into it? When you approached it and you said, I know how to stop myself by the end. I will know how to control myself before I actually commit the sin. You fooled yourself. A shaitan fooled you to believe that you are able to control yourself before falling into it. So you came closer and closer and closer. Once you got there, the closer you get, the weaker you become. And as a result, this is why people fall into sins. So Allah Azza wa Jal teaches us in these ayat, وَلَا تَقْرَبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ. Don't come near the sin. Don't come near it. You need to investigate and find out what are the things that make you fall into a sin and keep away from all these things. For example, az-zina. Az-zina is the major sin. Adultery is the major sin. What leads to it? What leads to it? You know, the things that lead to it, meeting up with a woman in private. Then what leads to that? Before that, speaking to a woman in private. Before that, looking, gazing at a woman with lust and desire. All of these are methods in how a person gets to the major sin. So when Allah Azza wa Jal says to Adam alayhi salam, don't come near the tree, don't approach it. You and I also learn from this. Do not approach any sin. Keep away from the sin. Whatever leads to it, keep away from it. Because you might be able to control the first step into this sin. You might be able to control it. But then but as you get closer and closer, you become weaker and weaker. And that's how you fall into the sin. SubhanAllah. Now, Allah Azza wa Jal says to Adam, don't come near this tree. Yani, the tree now has officially been recognized as a sin. Do not eat from it. SubhanAllah. Was the tree a sin before this command of Allah Azza wa Jal? No, it wasn't. And the tree only became haram when Allah Azza wa Jal told Adam, don't come near it. That's when it became haram. Well, subhanAllah, this is a question. Yani, did Allah Azza wa Jal create the haram from day one? And he made it haram from day one? No. For example, alcohol. Alcohol was actually permissible. Even Sahaba used to drink it. Then it became haram in one stage in the life of Rasulullah ﷺ when they were in Al-Madinah. For example, Al-Hijab. Woman, believing woman, used to walk without hijab. So it was permissible at one stage to be walking around in the presence of men without hijab. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated it. So from that moment onwards, it was impermissible for a woman to be seen by a non-mahram without covering her hair, without wearing her hijab. And similarly, upon Bani Israel, the fats of the animals was halal for them to consume. And then at one point, Allah Azza wa Jal made it haram. And he said to them, do not consume the fats of animals. So the idea is that the haram that Allah Azza wa Jal made haram was actually permissible before it was made haram. It was permissible, except for one thing, and that is a shirk. A shirku billah, associating partners with Allah, was always forbidden from day one. But there are matters that were permissible initially, and then they became haram, like we said about the alcohol and so on. So what do we learn from this? We learn from this that Allah Azza wa Jal legislates, and he makes things that were permissible haram for one reason. And that is to see who is going to obey Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, إِلَّا لِنَعْلَمْ مَنْ يَتَّبِعُ الرَّسُولِ مِمَّنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ. Who's going to obey Allah and his messenger? And who's going to fall and not obey Allah? And who's going to choose to disobey Allah and his messenger? SubhanAllah. Yani, can you imagine? Al-khamr, alcohol. Sahaba used to drink it. Then it became haram all of a sudden. Now we can discuss the wisdom behind why it was made haram, and because it's harmful, it intoxicates a person, the brain, it affects the liver of a person, and so many other harmful matters of al-khamr. However, the first and foremost reason for why Allah Azza wa Jal would made things that were permissible haram, the first, absolutely first reason is to see who is going to be Allah Azza wa Jal, who will obey Allah and his messenger. and who will disobey Allah and His Messenger. SubhanAllah, this is the lesson that we are supposed to learn. Who's going to prefer Allah's command over what He desires? This is the test. This is why Allah would say to Adam, وَلَا تَقْرَبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ Don't come near this tree. Before this command, there was nothing said about the tree. If Adam was to eat from it, there would have been nothing. But now Allah Azza wa Jal made it to test Adam alayhi salam. Would he come near this tree or not? Would he obey? And would he fall for his desire and temptation? Or is a person going to prefer Allah Azza wa Jal's command over that which he desires? وَلَا تَقْرَبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ What's the result? Anyone who falls into the sin or keeps falling into the sin, Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, فَتَكُونَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ But before this, there's another point in the word هَذِهِ When Allah Azza wa Jal says to Adam, do not come near this tree. The word هَذِهِ in the Arabic language, it's known as ism ishara lil qareeb. You use the word هَذِهِ when you refer to something that is close to you. For example, if there's a pen, this is a pen, it's close to me, I say هَذَا قَلَم If it was far away from me, I would say ذَاكَ قَلَم ذَاكَ قَلَم That is a pen. But if it's close, I say, this is a pen. Allah Azza wa Jal, when He forbid Adam to approach this tree, He said to him, do not approach this tree. In other words, it was close to Adam alayhi salam. In other words, it was clear. Allah Azza wa Jal showed him the sin. And He said to him, this is the tree that you're not supposed to come near. Is it clear? Can you see it? Can you hear the command? Is it very clear, sound and clear? Any questions? This is the idea. What we're learning is that when Allah Azza wa Jal make things haram, they are absolutely clear. There's no confusion about them. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says in the hadith, Al-halalu bayyinun wal-haramu bayyin. That matters that are made permissible are absolutely clear. Wal-haram is also absolutely clear. Al-halal bayyin wal-haramu bayyinun. So in other words, Al-haram is so clear. There is no confusion about what haram is. You know, today there are people that come out and make people confused about al-haram. Today there are people coming out to say that alcohol is not haram. These are people that are confusing mankind. These are people known as shayateen among mankind. Alcohol is haram, very clear in the Quran. Today there are people that are saying that Allah Azza wa Jal did not legislate al-hijab. When hijab is not something obligatory in Islam. These people are devils among the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are munafiqoon, hypocrites among the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are a student of Iblis. They are students of Iblis with shayateen. Allah Azza wa Jal legislated al-hijab and the ayat are so clear. So this is what we learn from qawlihi ta'ala, وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ This tree, can you see it, Ya Adam? Don't approach this tree. My brothers and sisters in Islam, permissibilities are so clear. And what Allah Azza wa Jal forbid is so clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then He says, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ Don't approach the tree. Because if you approach this tree, you are going to be from among the wrongdoers. That if you just come close to it, you're going to be a wrongdoer. Yani Allah Azza wa Jal, he declared a person a wrongdoer. The fact that he comes close to the sin. Why? Because when you come close to it, that's it. You become weaker and weaker and weaker. Inevitably, you will fall into this sin. So Allah Azza wa Jal declared a wrongdoer, a person who just approaches the sin. You won't be able to control yourself if you approach it. This is why keep far away from it as best as you can. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal is telling Adam alayhi salam. فَتَكُونَا Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَتَكُونَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ If both of you approach this tree, Ya Adam and your wife Hawa, if both of you approach this tree, then both of you are going to be from the wrongdoers. And what we learn from this is that both men and women are responsible for their sins. Each one is responsible for his sin. It is wrong that if a wife was to fall into a sin, that she come and say, it was because of my husband I fell into the sin. And it is wrong for a husband that wal'iyadhu billah fornicates. And then he comes, and when he's exposed, he says, yeah, because it's my wife. She doesn't beautify herself to me. She doesn't sleep with me. She does 1, 2, 3. So as a result, I fell into the sin because of her. That is absolutely wrong. And you cannot justify a sin in this manner. Allah Azza wa Jal, He said to both Adam and Hawa, فَتَكُونَا. Both of you are going to be responsible for your sin, and both of you are going to be wrongdoers. How many times today, how many times do we hear from a husband justifying his sin because of his wife? You know, she's not dressed well, she doesn't give me any attention. And how many times does a wife justify her sin because of her husband's doings? He's not giving me attention, he doesn't give me love, he doesn't give me support. So as a result, I had to cheat on him. Allah Azza wa Jal says to Adam and Hawa, both of you, if you approach this tree, then both of you are going to be responsible for your sin. No one can blame the other. Subhanallah. What we learn is that at the end of the day, you're responsible. No one, the person you're trying to blame for your sin, he won't help you on the day of judgment. Nor is this a valid case before Allah Azza wa Jal. And each will be asked for his sin on his own on the day of judgment. Each is accountable for himself on the day of judgment, subhanallah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, فَتَكُونَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, Allahu Akbar, listen to this. Listen to how a shaitan works. Because if you understand his plot and plan, you're at a better chance to helping yourself fall into his traps. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَ الشَّيْطَانَ. الشيطان, evil, whispered to them. But do you see the fat here? Notice, pay attention to the fact. Look what's happening. Allah Azza wa Jal said to Adam, don't come near this tree. He showed him the tree. It was very clear. Adam understood the message. Allah would say to him, if you come near it, you become a wrongdoer. Allah Azza wa Jal then said, immediately, as soon as Allah had given the instruction to Adam to keep away from the tree, a shaitan came. There is no rest. A shaitan doesn't rest. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in the hadith, قِيلُوا فَإِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ لَا تَقِيلُ. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, have a rest, have a nap during the day, sleep. The shayateen do not sleep. Ash-shaytan doesn't sleep. فَوَسْوَسَ, immediately, he's on the back of Adam. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, he immediately whispered to both of them. فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ, to both of them. And the word waswasa, It comes from the word was, was. Can you see the repetition in the word was, was? What that implies is that the evil whispering of a shaitan is something continuous, something that happens over and over and over again. A shaitan doesn't evil whisper to a person once and then he leaves him. No, you're able to fight yourself. How many times an evil thought came in your mind and you're able to repel it from first time? Shaitan would come again, and he would come again, just like he did with our father Adam alayhi salam. Came to him time after time after time. Well, waswasa is something secret that is heard within a person. لأن الوسوسة, when يعني العلماء رحمهم الله explained the linguistic meaning of waswasa, they said like the Arabs would say waswasa الحلي. You know, a woman when she wears earrings, and the earrings, like the double earrings for example, and they tap with each other and they make that sound, that kind of touching sound, that's called a waswasa. In other words, it's close to the ear, only one person can hear it. And so al-waswasa, waswasa to shaytan, it's like that. It's a recurring sound within the conscience of a person. A shaytan doesn't let go of such a people. The only thing that is able to repel him is to seek refuge in Allah Azza wa Jal from him. To say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. To read Surah Al-Ikhlas, to read Surah Al-Nas, Surah Al-Falaq, to make dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal, this is a sword against waswasa to shaytan that keeps him away. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ. Ash-shaytan whispered to both of them, both of them. You see, both of them, both are responsible for their sin and what they fell into. لَهُمَا, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, لِيُبْدِيَ لَهُمَا مَا وُورِيَ عَنْهُمَا مِنْ سَوْآتِهِمَا. He whispered to them in order to remove the clothing that had covered their privates. Now, what does this mean? Iblis doesn't know that the result of Adam when he eats from this tree is going to be that his clothes are going to come off. He doesn't know that. So this lam here, al-ulama rahimahumullah, they said it's known as lam al-aqibah, meaning that al-shaytan whispered to Adam, evil whispered to Adam, trying to bring him closer and closer to this tree to eat from it. And the result of the whispering of Adam is going to be that his clothes are going to come off, subhanAllah, to expose that which was concealed of their privates. And that, subhanAllah, has always been the plan of a shaytan, to remove the clothes of Bani Adam. Because the majority of sins occur when the clothes of people are removed. SubhanAllah, every time a person falls into something that is haram, yani in the major harams of az-zina, this is the biggest industry today in the world. It's people removing their clothes off. That's the biggest industry in today's world. People removing their clothes for scenes, for pornography, for whatever it is that they call. SubhanAllah. For this, we need to be careful. This is exactly what a shaytan always aims to bring for people. The more clothes he can remove off you, the closer and closer you come to the evil plans of a shaytan. لِيُبْدِيَ لَهُمَا مَا وُورِيَ عَنْهُمَا مِنْ سَوْآتِهِمَا. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, now Allah Azza wa Jal is going to explain to us how Iblis, how a shaytan tempted Adam alayhi salam. How did he bring him to this sin? And listen to me very carefully, because this is going to be an absolute crucial point, and it is something that we already see in this worldly life. Very important. How did he tempt Adam alayhi salam, a prophet of Allah, who heard the clear message of Allah, don't come near this tree? How did he tempt him into falling into this tree and eating from it, or coming near it and tasting it? Allah Azza wa Jal, he says that الشيطان said, قَالَ وَقَالَ مَا نَهَاكُمَا رَبُّكُمَا عَنْ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ مَلَكَيْنِ أَوْ تَكُونَ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, something that we see even to today. Let me explain to you what it means. الشيطان, from his whispering to Adam, what did he whisper? He said to him that, listen to me. He said to Adam, listen. Allah did not forbid you from this tree, except because he doesn't want to make you two kings. Adam and Hawa, Allah doesn't want you, both of you, to be kings. So he forbid you from the tree. أَوْ تَكُونَ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ. And Allah doesn't want you to be in here forever. So he said to him, Adam, isn't this paradise beautiful? Don't you want to be a king? Don't you want to live in the paradise forever? Don't you want that? Allah forbid you from this tree because that's its effect. That's what it does. It brings you goodness. It makes you a king if you ate from it. It makes you live in here forever. SubhanAllah. Ash-shaytan decorated the sin. This is what he did. He decorated the sin. In Surah Taha, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says that Iblis said to Adam, هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكِ اللَّهِ يَبْلَى. Shall I take you to a tree that if you were to eat from, you will live forever? This is the tree of life, شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ, the tree of life. Allahu Akbar. Allah Azza wa Jal called it the tree that is haram and forbidden. And he's Iblis giving it a name other than its name, beautifying and decorating the sin by saying to Adam, Adam, this is called the tree of life. If you were to eat from it, you will stay in the paradise forever and ever. You will become a king. You will own what you like. You will roam around the way you want. Allahu Akbar. And how many times has the shaytan done this with us? For every sin we fall into, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. That a shaytan beautifies and he decorates the sins for the people. He decorates it for them, subhanAllah. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, he tells us that one of the signs of the Day of Judgment at the end of time, يُسَمُّونَهُ بِغَيْرِ اسْمِهِ. People will give the haram a name other than its name. SubhanAllah. Yani for example, الربا, interest. What's it called today? Benefits. You see how nice that name sounds? Benefits. الربا is the denounced name. the negative name, the haram name that we know about. But today, the banks would call it benefits. Islamic banks would call it al-fawaid. Fawaid, it just sounds like something good. Subhanallah. Az-zina, fornication and adultery. In the world, it's not called that. What do they call it? They call it entertainment. Personal services. Like a beautiful name to it. Subhanallah. This is the plan of a shaitan. You better be careful, my brothers and sisters in Islam. A shaitan takes the nasty name that we know for the sin, the repulsive name that Allah gave the sins, the negative name that's given to them, and he converts it in something beautiful that sounds pleasing to the ears and pleasing to the hearts. A zina, it's called personal service, entertainment. And you see the brothels that are out there, what kind of names people give them, what kind of beautiful names people give them. Moonlight, for example, and other names that are pleasing to the ear and pleasing to the heart, so that the sin now is disguised and you don't even know about it. Alcohol. What do they call alcohol? Spirits. You know, in Arabic, they call it mashrubat ruhiyya. It's like a spiritual drink. It uplifts your spirit. When Allah called it al-khamr, you see the word al-khamr, that kha in it, it gives it the nastiness that khamr is. Subhanallah, drugs. What names do people give it today? They give it the name of speed. You know, sounds good, speed gives you a rush in this life. Ecstasy means overwhelming happiness. This is what ecstasy means, it means happiness. How did something pathetic, such as a drug, become called ecstasy, which means happiness? It's the plan of the shaitan. He removes the nasty name of the haram and he replaces it with something that sounds pleasing to the ears. Subhanallah, it's incredible. We have ice, like it just sounds cool. It sounds perfect. Marijuana, they call it cannabis, it's like a plant, it's an innocent plant. And this has been the plot of a shaitan from day one with Adam alayhi salam. Allah Azza wa Jal told Adam, don't come near this tree, this forbidden tree. Yet when Iblis would give him waswasa, he'd say to him, shajarat al-khuld. This is the tree of life. If you were to eat from it, you're going to live forever. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah told us this. And Allah told us the sin of Adam alayhi salam. Can you realize now for why Allah would tell us the sin of Adam? Not to expose Adam, but to teach us. We're supposed to be inspired by the sin of Adam alayhi salam, so that we are more careful when a shaitan next time comes to fool us and trick us. When this entire world doesn't name what's haram anymore. They give it other than its name. This is from the plans of a shaitan from day one. He did that with Adam alayhi salam. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, يُسَمُّونَهُ بِغَيْرِ اسْمِهِ, that people will call the sins other than what they are known for. That's how shaitan deceives us. That's what he whispered to Adam. He decorated the sin for him. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, you know the mushrikeen, the disbelievers of Mecca, when they used to kill their children, how did they end up killing their children? Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ زَيَّنَ لِكَثِيرٍ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ قَتْلَ أَوْلَادِهِمْ شُرَكَاؤُمْ. زَيَّنَ, it was decorated for them. They thought it was a good sin. They thought it was a good thing. Let's bury our daughters alive. Yeah, it sounds good because it's going to give us honor. It's going to give us our manhood in the community. And you know, it's not going to be an embarrassment for us. Allahu Akbar. A shaitan took something that is haram and he made it that beautiful to people to the point where they were so fooled. They thought burying their daughters was a good thing, was a positive in their life, was something that is going to bring them more honor and dignity among their people. How foolish can man be when they follow the footsteps of a shaitan? But yet again, the problem is because we don't understand the methodology of a shaitan, so we easily fall into his traps. This is why it's important to understand what the shaitan intends to do with mankind and how he deceives them, how he fools them. Subhanallah, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, when Allah Azza wa Jal spoke about iman, he said, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. As for a believer,
Allah Azza wa Jal made indeed to his heart al-Iman. وَزَيَّنَهُ And Allah decorated al-Iman in our hearts. The believer sees sweetness in Iman. He sees happiness. His eyes become cool and delighted when he sees the worship of Allah. When he hears the word of Allah calling him to the worship of Allah. And the fact that Allah decorated and beautified Iman in our hearts, that means the hearts, they are allergic to sins. The heart of a true believer, it's allergic to sins. We're going to see now when Adam fell into his sin, what happened? To teach you how a believer is allergic to sins. How it's like water and oil, they don't mix. The heart of the believer is the water. The oil is the sins that's coming on it. It might touch his heart. He might do something, but very quick it fades and it doesn't mix into his Iman. The believer preserves his Iman. He keeps it clean. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ Now, Adam alayhi salam paid attention to Iblis. Remember, this is the first time Iblis ever whispered to anyone of mankind. So Adam doesn't have a role model before him to understand what kind of evil intentions does a shaitan have and what plans does a shaitan have. So Adam alayhi salam had no role model, but we can learn from Adam. But let's see how Adam fell into this sin. And why did Adam listen to Iblis and kind of accept what Iblis said and went ahead and ate from this tree, tasted from this tree? What did Iblis promise? What did Iblis say? Iblis said that if you eat from this tree, you will live forever, right? He said to him, you'll become a king, malakain, aw takuna min al-khalidin, you'll live forever. طيب. Mankind has a lust to live forever. Mankind, we as human beings, love to live for a long time. I mean, everyone that's watching now, and everyone that's watching in the future, if I was to ask you, do you want to die now, or you want to live? Pretty much everyone wants to live for so many reasons. You got a lot of things you want to live for. You're probably not ready to die now. You want to make a tawbah before you. Allahu Akbar. Everyone wants to live. That's something that Allah put inside of us. No one wants to die as soon as he can. Everyone wants to live. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he says in the Quran that he gave the believers a reward in the paradise, which is hum fiha khalidun. You've heard of this ayah. When Allah describes the reward he's given us in the paradise, he said, أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ That the people of the paradise live in there forever. Because living forever is a reward. It's something that everyone looks forward to. So Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to us as a reward in the paradise. Hud alayhi salam, when he came past Aad, and he saw him building their buildings and how strong and mega structures that they build, that you know, they carve their buildings from stone and rocks. He said to them, وَتَتَّخِذُونَ مَصَانِعَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَخْلُدُونَ He said to him, what are you people doing? You're building these gigantic houses. It's as though you're going to live forever. See, this is the nature of man. He wants to live forever. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ الَّذِي جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدَ يَحْسَبُ أَنَّ مَالَهُ أَخْلَدَهُ Human being, he thinks that his money will make him live forever. Because with money, he can buy food to continue nourish himself. He can afford medical treatment for himself to live forever. Even then, if the human being died, he relies on his money. That his name lives forever after his death. You know how people donate to build hospitals just so he can have a plaque with his name with it so his name can live forever. The idea of the human being living forever. If his body cannot live forever, he wants his name to live forever. So Adam alayhi salam, no different to any other human being, he had the desire to live forever. And the shaitan is telling him, eat from this tree, you will live forever. Put one with one, what happens? This is exactly what's going to happen. Adam alayhi salam is going to fall in the sin, no doubt. And you know the reality about life forever. Let's just understand this since we opened this topic. Living for a long, is that something good or something that is detested bil Quran wa sunnah? The reality is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ That the best among you are those who live a long life filled with goodness and piety and worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. So if you want or you desire a longer life, plan that it be for Allah's sake, that you fill it with worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. And in the same hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَشَرُّكُمْ مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَسَاءَ عَمَلُهُ And the worst, Allahu Akbar, can you imagine the worst among mankind? Are those who lived a long life full of sin, disobedience, and rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in reality, yes, mankind has a desire to live a long life. But this long life, if it's filled with goodness, then that's a good desire. That's something that you're rewarded for, bi-ithnihi ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal, then he says, so now the shaitan has decorated the sin. You're with me now. He's decorated. He's told them, if you eat from it, you from this tree, you'll live forever. Now, Adam still hasn't come near this tree. So what did the shaitan do? Listen to this carefully. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا لَمِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. Still Adam is hesitant. Allah has told him, don't come near this tree. So he's afraid. He doesn't want to come near it. Ash-shaytan has pushed him a little bit further when he said to him that this is the tree of life. If you ate, you'll live forever. Allah Azza wa Jalla then said, Ash-shaytan, قَاسَمَهُمَا. He swore to both of them. He said to them, أُقْسِمُ بِاللَّهِ. He said to them, وَاللَّهِ I'm an honest, sincere advisor to you. Allahu Akbar. Can you imagine this? Yani, he's lying. He's telling them, وَاللَّهِ I only want good for you too. وَاللَّهِ I don't want to deceive you. أُقْسِمُ بِاللَّهِ I am an absolute, sincere advisor to you. And you know, Adam ate from the tree. But al-ulama, rahimahumullah, said that the reason for why Adam ate from the tree, because Adam never ever expected that a person would ever use the name of Allah Azza wa Jal and swear by Allah to a lie. Iblis said, Uqsimu billah, I am advising you, and I am a sincere advisor to you, that if you eat from this tree, you will live forever. So Adam alayhi salam, the last thing that pushed him towards eating from this tree was because he never thought anyone would use Allah's name and ascribe it to a lie. How many of us are devils on earth today that ascribe Allah's name with a lie? How do you do that? How do people use Allah's name to lie? Adam fell into the sin because of something like this. Allah, the one that's supposed to be honored, Allah, the one that you're supposed to be saying, La ilaha illa hu, you're using his name to lie. Subhanallah, subhanallah. But this is something that we should be careful of. We should understand why. What was the last push for Adam to eat from the tree? It was the fact that Iblis used the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lie. And Adam never thought anyone would do that. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he tells us, وَحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ. Safeguard your oath. Don't use Allah's name loosely. Don't use it loosely. For everything you do, for every second you think of it, Wallah, Wallahi, أُقْسِمُ بِاللَّهِ, Wallah this, Wallah. And then, ya Allah, mix it in with your lies, with your truth. You couldn't care less. Wallahi, such people have yet to honor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, from among his 99 names, you know what the greatest of them is? The greatest of Allah's names is Allah. So we need to be extra careful when we use the word Allah and how it comes out of our tongues, and how, first and foremost, how it comes out of our heart, with what intention. And you have people using the most honored name of Allah so loosely, and they ascribe Allah's name to a lie. That's a trait of Iblis, who couldn't care less. So he came to Adam and he said to him, Wallahi, I'm a sincere advisor. Go and eat from the tree, you'll live forever. Subhanallah. And how many people do that? Allahu Akbar. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, وَلَا تَجْعَلُوا اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ أَن تَبَرُّوا وَتَتَّقُوا وَتُصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. Don't use Allah's name. وَلَا تَجْعَلُوا اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ أَن تَبَرُّوا. Don't use Allah's name. You know, swear by Allah Azza wa Jal, take an oath by Allah's name to serve your purposes. Basically, in the ayah, that's what it is. To serve your purposes. Subhanallah. Fear Allah Azza wa Jal. Fear Allah Azza wa Jal. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا لَمِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. And here, there's a beautiful point to learn and understand. Al-ulama, rahimahumullah, they said this. Listen to it carefully. They said, if this is how Iblis deceived Adam when he took an oath that he's going to be a sincere advisor to him, yet he deceived him, imagine how much worse is the deception of Iblis towards mankind going to be when he has taken an oath that he'll deceive us. Did you listen to that? Did you understand it? Let me repeat it so you can understand it. Al-ulama said, if this was how Iblis deceived Adam, that he took an oath by Allah, he's a sincere advisor, yet he deceived Adam, imagine then the deception of Iblis against mankind when he has already taken an oath by Allah that he is going to deceive us. لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صَلَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and sisters in Islam, we are in a war. Wallahi, we are in a war with Iblis and his entire army of shayateen that we can see, and his entire army of shayateen from among human beings. Yes, there is shayateen among the mankind. There is shayateen. These are the same people that have changed the haram names that Allah has given certain things into luxurious names, into pleasurable names. These are the army of Iblis. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. Shayateen from al-ins, from mankind, and shayateen from the devils, from al-jinn kind. There's shayateen on both ends. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in Surah An-Nas, what do we say? Min sharril waswasi al-khannas alladhi yuwaswisu fi suduri an-nas min al-what? Min al-jinnati wan-nas. There are shayateen from the jinn kind and shayateen from mankind. We need to be careful from all these devils. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا لَمِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ فَدَلَّاهُمَا بِغُرُورٍ. Now, Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us exactly how this sin happened and what happened. Listen carefully. Wallahi, every ayah is gold here. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, فَدَلَّاهُمَا بِغُرُورٍ. He began to lead them into his deceptive plan. دَلَّاهُمَا, from the word dalla. Dalla is to direct someone to something. Shaytan is doing a service to you when he wants to make you fall into al-haram. He guides you to it. You know how there's like today the Google Maps that will take you to al-masjid, to permissible places. Shaytan has his own maps in where he guides a person to the sin. He opens up the path and the road so he can make the sin easy, accessible for him. Dallahuma. And the word dallahuma also comes from the word dalu. What dalu is to reel in the bucket that has went into the well. You know, a well, it goes into the bucket, goes into the well, and then you reel it in. How do you reel it? Bit by bit. This is what Iblis did with Adam. He reeled him in bit by bit until he got him to this tree. And we discovered in the ayat, in the way and the form, how he brought Adam alayhi salam closer to this tree. فَدَلَّهُمَا بِغُرُورٍ, with lies. He guided him to the sin with lies, بغرور, with deception. Yeah, he used Allah's name for his lying. He doesn't care. He just did anything he can to bring him in. He changed the name. He said to him, this is Shajarat al-Khuld. He took an oath by Allah. This is the deceptive forms in how he brought Adam alayhi salam closer to this tree. Allah Azza wa Jal, then he says, Allahu Akbar, this is the point of the sin. فَلَمَّا ذَاقَ الشَّجَرَةِ. Allah, may Allah Azza wa Jal forgive us. But finally, Adam alayhi salam, Allah Azza wa Jal says, falamma. This word, falamma, it's used to prolong events between one event to another. So it means after a long time, eventually, Adam alayhi salam fell into this evil plan of a shaytan. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, falamma, finally, after a long time, when they both tasted from the tree. They put a fruit, they just tasted it. You know what happened? Listen carefully. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا. Their private parts became exposed immediately. Immediately. They didn't even enjoy the fruit yet. They haven't even enjoyed it. Yani they didn't even swallow. Just ذَاقَ, they only tasted the fruit and their clothes came off immediately. Subhanallah, my brothers and sisters in Islam, there is no enjoyment in sins. He didn't even enjoy the sin. Subhanallah. And the punishment straight away came. The consequence of the sin came straight away. The effect of the sin came straight away. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Their shames, their privates were uncovered. Allahu Akbar. And you know what? This is actually something good. This is something good. When Allah Azza wa Jal wants goodness for a person, He reprimands him for his sin immediately. He shows him the consequence of the sin immediately. So because Allah Azza wa Jal loves Adam alayhi salam, He showed him the consequences of the sin immediately before he could enjoy it. Because Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't want the believer to enjoy other than al-halal, other than his relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal. So as soon as he tasted the tree, Allah removed his cloth so that he throws it away and he focuses on his shame. And he focuses and he begins to regret and he worries immediately after the sin. And that's the first condition of a tawbah. And that's the first thing Adam alayhi salam did. Wallahi, it is a punishment. When you sin and you enjoy the sin and you see just blessings are coming one after the other and you don't see consequences of your sin and all is good, Allahu Akbar. This al-ulama called the istidraj. When Allah Azza wa Jal wants to really punish a person, He lets him enjoy the sin. He lets him enjoy the sin. Keep on enjoying. Keep going. Keep going. Maybe this guy wakes up one day. Maybe he makes a tawbah one day. Maybe he reforms one day. Until if it's been too much and you've been given more than one chance, punishment comes immediately and such people are destroyed by Allah Azza wa Jal. So because Allah Azza wa Jal loves Adam alayhi salam, He made him, He gave him the consequences of the sin immediately. And that is that his clothes were removed straight after the sin. Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't want the believer to enjoy the sin. Subhanallah. Inna Allah yaghar. This is a hadith that Allah is jealous. And Allah's jealousy is when a believer crosses the line. When a believer violates the laws and commands of Allah, that's when Allah becomes jealous. Subhanallah. Do you feel this? Do you feel this? It upsets, it displeases Allah. It angers Allah that a believer falls in a sin. Where is the heart? My brothers and sisters in Islam, when a person commits a sin or approaches a sin, where is your conscience? Where is it? Where is it? Isn't there something in your mind, in your heart, that awakens this honor of Allah Azza wa Jal within you? That awakens this taqwa within you? To fear Allah Azza wa Jal when you approach a sin. How many sins are committed today on earth loosely? How much of it? And Allah Azza wa Jal holds his punishment back. And Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't destroy such a person. Subhanallah. Out of mercy for such people. In hope they might repent. In hope they might wake up. Not the fact that Allah didn't see it. Allah saw it. And Allah sees what you do. Where is this kind of knowledge in your life that Allah Azza wa Jal sees you? Wallahi, the absolute and most important knowledge you need during a sin is that Allah Azza wa Jal sees you. In Surah Al-Alaq, Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَىٰ. Doesn't He know that Allah Azza wa Jal sees? The question is, do you know or not? Do you know or not? Allah called the fact that you know He sees you, He called it ilm. He called it knowledge. Alam ya'lam. The greatest knowledge on earth, my brothers and sisters in Islam, is to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees you. This is why this level was called al-ihsan. It was called al-ihsan, to know that Allah azza wa jal sees you and that you worship Allah as though you can see Him. Where is that feeling? At the moment of the sin, in the midst of the sin, you are supposed to remember Allah azza wa jal. You're supposed to remember Him. Because by that time, you are weak. You're finished. That's it. Your intellect, your brain is dead. The desire has overtaken you. You know, people that watch clips, haram clips, people that do what's haram in private and sin alone. At that time, the brain is dead. The brain is covered. Desire has overtaken your mind, has overtaken the heart. Has it overtaken yourself? What do you need at that time? You need dhikrullahi azza wa jal. You need the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. When Yusuf alayhi salam was in that room with the wife of the king, imagine that beautiful looking lady, and she's the one who's calling him to the scene. She's prepared herself. She said to him, "Hayta lak." What's the first thing he said when he was in the middle of that scene? He said to her, "Ma'ad Allah." He said, "I fear Allah." And he began to run. He began to run to the door. That's what you're supposed to be doing in the middle of a sin. Ma'ath Allah, scream it out. Awaken, awaken the taqwa of Allah in your heart. Awaken it. Let it flourish and flood onto your body and on your limbs. He said, Ma'ath Allah. And he ran to the door. That's what you're supposed to do. And then eventually what happened with Yusuf alayhi salam? وَأَلْفَيَا سَيِّدَهَا لَدَ الْبَابَ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. Refuge came, refuge came. The door opened and the king was at the door. My brothers and sisters in Islam, between the peak of your desire and just about to fall into the sin, between that and Allah saving you from the sin, it's just a couple of minutes. It's only a couple of minutes. Yusuf alayhi salam, from when he said ma'ad Allah until he ran to the door, by then alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jal saved him, and the king is there, and people are there. She forgot her sin, she took away, and Yusuf alayhi salam now is completely in control of his mind and himself, subhanallah. That's what's supposed to happen during a sin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he removed the clothes of Adam so that he doesn't enjoy the sin. So that if you find yourself sinning and sinning, and you don't find that Allah Azza wa Jal has yet done anything for you for your sin, then be careful and repent to Allah Azza wa Jal, because a punishment is just around the corner. It can come any time. Allahu A'lam. Lakin Allahu As-Sabur. Allah Azza wa Jal is the all patient. He's patient with his slaves until maybe you wake up, maybe you make a tawbah. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, فَلَمَّا ذَاقَ الشَّجَرَةَ بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. And they immediately, both Adam and Hawa, rushed to remove leaves from the tree and put them together to make clothing to cover their privates. Allahu Akbar. Adam and Hawa in the paradise, there is absolutely no human being in the paradise except them two. They are husband and wife, yet why are they covering themselves? From what? That's the modesty that Allah Azza wa Jal put in Adam and put in mankind. They want to keep themselves covered. Even if you're alone in the room, you know, it's him and his wife. And they have the entire paradise for themselves. Why is he rushing to cover himself for? Why? That's the modesty Allah Azza wa Jal taught us and instilled inside of us. Subhanallah. Now, so طَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. This is why a companion once asked the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if I was alone, I mean, should a person be covered when he's alone? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَاللَّهُ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُسْتَحْيَى مِنْ. That Allah Azza wa Jal has more right that we are shy from him. That we are shy from him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you're sleeping even in a room alone, it is makruh, yani it's disliked that you sleep naked, even though it's permissible if a person was to do so. And people used to do that before, especially when there were no air conditions and living in the heat, in the tents, and their clothes become sweaty, and that's the only pair of clothes they have, so they would remove their clothes and sleep without clothes. But alhamdulillah, now with the ni'mah of air conditioning and so on, remember the hadith, فَاللَّهُ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُسْتَحْيَى مِنْ. Yeah, if there's no one in the room in where you have to dress so that they don't see you, remember Allah sees you at all times, and Allah is more worthy and has more right that we be shy of Allah Azza wa Jal than anyone else. وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. They began to bring the leaves of the tree to put them together to make clothing for themselves. يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. Subhanallah, how beautiful is this modesty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us. Yet, as I said to you initially, that the biggest industry today is an industry that promotes the removing away from clothes of mankind. Allahu Akbar. The pornography industry, the entertainment industry. This is all they vie for. This is all they want. How are we going to remove the people's clothes? And we see in this story, Adam alayhi salam and his wife Hawa, husband and wife in the paradise by themselves. Their clothes are gone, yet they are so embarrassed and shy and regret and feel sorrow and sadness and remorse for the sin they committed that they rush to cover their privates. Subhanallah. وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا. And as they're collecting these leaves to wear their clothing, Allah Azza wa Jal called them. Allahu Akbar. وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا. Their Lord called them. You know what you learn from this word, رَبُّهُمَا? You learn that He's still their Lord. Even though you commit the sin, Allah is still your Lord. Yani, don't ever allow the shaytan to make this even worse than what it is. And you begin to have negative thoughts of Allah. You know, you fall into the sin. And then what's much worse, a shaytan doesn't stop there. Shaytan will continue. A shaytan will tell you, you hypocrite, you disobeyed Allah. Now you're going to what? Get up and wear your clothes now, and you're going to go have an ghusl. And then what are you going to do after that? You hypocrite. Khalas, don't worry about it. And then you're going to pray. And you're going to ask Allah for tawbah. Forget it. You hypocrite. Give up hope in Allah's mercy. Allah won't forgive you. Allah's mercy isn't for people like you. Ya akhwani, my brothers and sisters in Islam. Ash-shaytan doesn't stop the moment you end your sin. That's just the start. Now he started. Now he warms up. Because falling into the sin, all mankind do this. Now he starts. How is he going to keep you away from Allah's mercy? How is he going to keep you from Allah's forgiveness? How is he going to keep you away from worshipping Allah and making a tawbah and getting up and praying two rak'at that very same second? Or you know, is saying, La ilaha illallah, astaghfirullah for what I did. He wants to try to keep you away from these words. Understand that the journey is long with Iblis. It's a long fight. It's a long fight, my brothers and sisters in Islam. It doesn't stop. This is why a believer who dies as a Muslim deserves to enter the paradise. You won the greatest battle on earth, which was the battle with yourself against the shaitan. That's the greatest battle on earth. And it is the first and foremost battle that each and every single one of us must fight before we fight any other enemy. That's the first enemy we need to fight. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا. Their Lord called them. You see how much love there is in this word, رَبُّهُمَا. Okay, you fell into the sin, but he's still your Lord. And I tell you something on this note. What is the best dhikr to make when a person falls into a sin? Obviously, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he teaches us, and this is a sahih hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, something called Sayyidul Istighfar. Sayyidul Istighfar. The master of seeking Allah's forgiveness. That if you say these words, these are the top of the top range in seeking Allah's forgiveness. And they are supposed to be said once in the morning, once in the afternoon. But have you ever thought of what it means? Sayyid al-istighfar. Sayyid. You know, when someone has a problem in his life, who does he run to? He runs to his master. If someone has a problem now, where do you run? You run to those that are above you. You run to the king, you run to the president, you run to the prime minister. You run to someone that can help you if you are in a big, big problem in your life. Tayyib, when we commit a sin, we need to run to Sayyidul Istighfar. The solution is in Sayyidul Istighfar. This is the master of all adhkar when it comes to seeking Allah's forgiveness. And then you know what the words in it are? You say, Allahumma anta rabbi. Oh Allah, you are my Lord. You are saying this after a sin. In context, it means you're my Lord when I did the sin. You're my Lord during the sin. You're my Lord before the sin. You're my Lord after the sin. Even if I sinned against you, you're still my Lord. Allahumma anta rabbi, la ilaha illa ant. There is no Lord worthy of worship but you, ya Rab. Khalaqtani wa ana abduk. You created me and I'm your slave. Yes, even when I committed the sin, I'm still your slave. وَأَنَا عَبْدُكَ وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعَدِكَ وَاسْتَطَعْتَ. And I am trying to the best of my ability to do that which I promised, which is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ. This is the contract between us and Allah, that we worship Him. I'm trying my best, Ya Allah. Can you see the words of Sayyid al-Istighfar? When you say them and you understand their meaning and you're saying them after a sin, wallahi, you would feel how they are turning off the sin. You will feel it's like cold water being poured on a hot heart. Subhanallah. وأنا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. You're saying, Ya Allah, I seek refuge in you. Protect me from the evil I did. You're saying, Sayyid al-Istighfar, you're acknowledging it's evil. You're saying, Ya Allah, I know what I did is evil. من شر ما صنعت. And Allah, protect me from the evil of myself, the own evil that I did. أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. أبوء لك بنعمتك علي. I acknowledge your blessings upon me. I acknowledge your favor and your mercy upon me. وَأَبُوءُ لَكَ بِذَنْبِي أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيَّ وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي. And Ya Allah, I acknowledge my sin. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي فَغْفِرْ لِي. Forgive me, Ya Rabb. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. And I'm asking it from you, because no one forgives sins except you. Who do I turn to? وَظَنُّ أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. The believer knows there is no escape from Allah but to Allah Azza wa Jal. The believer knows that. There is no escape of your sins and of your worry and of your distress and your situation. There is no escape from it except through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا. Their Lord called them out. Allah Azza wa Jal, He said to both of them, أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَ الشَّجَرَةِ. Didn't I forbid you both from this tree? You remember when I told you that Allah Azza wa Jal does not punish a person until he questions him for why he committed the sin? Like Iblis, he was questioned when he refused to make the sajda. Allah told him what? مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَسْجُدَ إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ. What prevented you the second I told you to make a sajda? Now also in the case of Adam, Allah Azza wa Jal tells him, didn't I forbid you from approaching this tree? أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَا. Now notice the word تِلْكُمَا. تِلْكُمَا, Allah is saying to Adam, didn't I forbid you from that tree? تِلْكُمَا, it refers to something that is far. Because by now, Adam alayhi salam, him and his wife ran away from the tree. They are so far from the sin. And this is what you should do when you fall into a sin. Run away from it. Run away from it. Run, run. If you committed it once, run. How many people, wallahi, have told me about that if they were to commit a sin, they fall into it again and again and again, you know? They're sitting at home, they watch a clip, and they do something haram with this clip, they relieve themselves, and then they say, ah, what am I going to get up for now? Make ghusl, make a tawbah and istighfar, what for? Let's give me a few more minutes, and I'll commit the sin again. That way I'll just make one ghusl, I'll bunch it all up in one, and one tawbah and one istighfar. Allahu Akbar. Adam alayhi salam, when he tasted from this tree once, when Allah came to tell him, why did you eat from the tree? He said to him, didn't I forbid you to come close to that tree? He's moved far away from it, Adam, now. He's far away from it. He didn't say, oh, we ate from it, right? Now let's just eat it now. We tasted it, our clothes came on, let's just eat some. He didn't do that. Alayhi salam. So we're learning from this that when you fall in the sin once, run, run away, run. Don't fall into it again. Yani, getting up is better than falling again. Committing the sin a second time round is committing it once and moving ahead and making tawbah is better than committing it twice and then making a tawbah. Wallahu a'lam. And Allah Azza wa Jal forgives all sins. أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَ الشَّجَرَةِ. أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا. And I want you to remember these two words every time you commit a sin. Allah is not just saying this to Adam alayhi salam. These are in fact words that are told to each and every single person that falls into a sin. أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا. Didn't I forbid you? Even on the day of judgment when we stand before Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah addresses all mankind. And He says to us, all of us, أَلَمْ أَعْهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ يَا بَنِي آدَمْ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ الشَّيْطَانِ. Didn't I tell you, O mankind, do not worship the shaytan? إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. He's an absolute clear enemy to all of you. وَأَنِ اعْبُدُونِي. Didn't I also tell you, worship me? هَذَا صِرَاطٌ مُسْتَقِيمٌ. And if you were to worship me, that would have been the straight path. Didn't I tell you that? أي والله صدق الله العظيم. Allah Azza wa Jal told us that. There we're reading it in the Qur'an. We're sharing it now. If you never knew it, now you know it. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. وَأَقُلْ لَكُمَا إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمَا عَدُوٌ مُّبِينٌ. So Allah asked Adam a question. When Iblis was asked the question, why did you refuse to make a sajda? We saw what he did. He justified his sin. He blamed Allah for his sin. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ He said, I'm better than Adam. And then he said, فَبِمَا أَغْوَيْتَنِي You, Allah. You made me fall into the sin. You deceived me. Now let's see Adam's response. So you can understand the difference between earning Allah's mercy and earning Allah's curse. Iblis was cursed when he blamed Allah for his sin. When he justified his sin by saying, You, Allah, caused me to do this. And he was cursed when he justified his sin by saying, I'm better than Adam. Adam, alayhi salam, however, committed the sin as well. But he earned Allah's mercy. Why? Listen to how he responded to the sin. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, immediately Adam, when he was questioned, when Allah said to him, Didn't I forbid you from the tree? In other words, what made you fall into this tree? Adam alayhi salam said, Rabbana. Can you imagine? يعني, Adam alayhi salam and Hawa, they began with the word Rabbana. يعني, Rabbana, you're our Lord. No doubt. We still acknowledge you are our Lord. 100%. Rabbana. And they are calling Allah Azza wa Jal in the most beautiful of His names, and all of Allah's names and attributes are beautiful. But there's a special relationship between the believer and the word Rabbana. Rabbana, it comes from the word Rabb. And Rabb is the one who nurtures us, the one who looks after us. It comes from the word Tarbiyah. Tarbiyah is the upbringing. When you discipline a child, when the parents, the mother and the father, they look after a child, that's called Tarbiyah. It's because you discipline, you nurture the child, you look after him, you make sure that his provisions are safe for him, you make sure where he lives it's a safe environment. As a parent, that's what you're supposed to do to your children. That process is called tarbiyah. There's a lot of love and care and mercy in it. So Adam and Hawa, they both say Rabbana. And you see the tawbah is for both, Adam and Hawa, because both of them are responsible for their sins. Hawa didn't say, Ya Rabbi, well, it wasn't me, Adam got me to the tree. No, as the Christian story would mention, they say that she's Hawa is called Eve from the word evil, because she's the one who brought Adam alayhi salam to eat from the tree. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ That's an incorrect story. The Islamic story is that both of them are responsible for their sins each. So they both said, Rabbana, our Lord, our most compassionate and gentle and the best and kindest Lord we ever know of. That's the word Rabbana. There's a lot of love in that. ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا We wronged ourselves. So in other words, who did they blame? They blamed themselves. And they didn't justify their sin. They didn't say, Oh Rabb, you deceived us. When you sent us Iblis, you told us to do 1, 2, 3. You already knew this is going to happen. You are not allowed to justify your sin using Al-Qadr. It's not allowed, my brothers and sisters in Islam. Allah Azza wa Jal gave us all a responsibility. And Allah Azza wa Jal has decreed what we're going to do in life, yes. But at the same time, He's given us the choice. And if you fall into a sin, yes, Allah decreed this sin upon you. But what do you do after that? Do you say, Allah chose to put me in a sin? We already know this knowledge. But you don't utter this after a sin. We know that Allah Azza wa Jal is who decreed sins. And He decreed our life. The sins that we do, Allah decreed them and He knows about them. And the goodness that we do, Allah decreed it and He knows about them. But we take full responsibility. This is our humility before Allah Azza wa Jal. This is how we honor Allah Azza wa Jal. That you want to sit in a debate and a discussion with Allah Azza wa Jal to say, you put this on me. What about when good happens in life? Do people ascribe it back to Allah Azza wa Jal? How many times do we hear of people when they do good, they want to feel good about themselves? This is how arrogance and pride eventually happens in people. When they do good, yeah, I did the good. I did 1, 2, 3. And he wants his self to know, be known. Why don't you say Allah caused you to do the good and you give all the credit to Allah Azza wa Jal? Yet when people fall into the sin, that's when they want to blame Allah Azza wa Jal. Say Allah decreed it. But how is it fair? Subhanallah, what is this kind of honoring of Allah Azza wa Jal? This is disrespect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal clearly told us al-haram is haram. You chose to come near it. You could have chosen to be away from it. Why don't you keep away from the sin and then say, yeah, wallah, alhamdulillah, Allah decreed for me just about to fall in the sin and He decreed I come away from it. In brief, I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that blaming Allah for your sins is not going to work on the Day of Judgment. Allah Azza wa Jal has crushed this debate in the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says about the disbelievers that they will say, لو شاء الله ما أشركنا ولا آباؤنا ولا حرمنا من شيء كذلك كذب الذين من قبلهم حتى ذاقوا بأسنا قل هل عندكم من علم فتخرجوه لنا إن تتبعون إلا الظن وإن أنتم إلا تخرصون. Subhanallah, beautiful ayah in Surah Al-An'am. If someone heard it, I'd like for them to put it into the comments so people can read its translation. But there are people that said this. لو شاء الله. They will say, if Allah willed, ما أشركنا. We would have never committed shirk in our life. ولا آباؤنا. Not even our forefathers would have committed shirk in their lives. ولا حرمنا من شيء. And we would have never made what's impermissible permissible, and what's permissible impermissible. We would have never played around with Allah's law. So they're saying, Ya Rab, because you decreed it upon us, that's why we did it. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jal says, قُلْ هَلْ عِنْدَكُمْ مِنْ عِلْمٍ فَتُخْرِجُوهُ لَنَا. Do you have knowledge? Did you know that Allah decreed this upon you? Did you know Allah's decree upon you? Bring it out. Bring it out. Let's see it. The decree is knowledge with Allah Azza wa Jal alone. We don't know about it. We don't know that Allah Azza wa Jal has decreed upon us that we'll commit a sin. Why do you want to justify your sins with al-qadr when it hasn't even happened yet for future sins? You and I need to learn to humble ourselves before Allah. And we need to learn to respect Allah Azza wa Jal. And we need to learn that any time we fall in a sin, we blame ourselves. No one but ourselves. No, absolutely no one. Not husband blaming his wife. No wife blames her husband. No one blame anyone else. You blame yourself and move on. Like Adam alayhi salam, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, فَمَنْ وَجَدَ خَيْرًا فَلْيَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ وَجَدَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ فَلَا يَلُومَنَّ إِلَّا نَفْسَهُ. That if you did any good in life, ascribe it to Allah. Say Alhamdulillah. And if you did any good, don't blame but yourself. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the road to recovery from a sin, the way you recover from a sin, the way you earn Allah's forgiveness, number one, listen, that you feel bad for the sin, and that's a sign of belief. Like what Adam alayhi salam did, they immediately rushed to bring these leaves of the tree to put them in to cover themselves. It makes him feel bad. And that's the believer. Al-mu'minu man سَرَّتْهُ حَسَنَتُهُ وَأَسَاءَتْهُ سَيِّئَتُهُ. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the sign of a believer, he is happy when he does a good deed because he knows that's what pleases Allah. And he feels bad when he commits a sin because he knows that this pleases Allah azza wa jal. That's number one. Number two, fingers on yourself. Fingers to yourself. ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. We wronged ourselves. I did the wrong. No one to blame. Allah is perfect. Subhanak. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. I blamed myself. Like Yunus alayhi salam. What did Yunus say? Yunus would say, when he did the sin of running away from his people and he wasn't given permission to take off, he left his people. Allah didn't tell him leave them. He ended up in the belly of the whale. What did he say? He said, Subhanak. Perfection belongs to you, Allah. You have nothing to do with my sin. Inni, it was me. Kuntu min al-zalimin. I'm the one who wronged myself. So they said, Rabbana zalamna anfusana. Wa in lam taghfir lana. Now you begin to ask Allah for His forgiveness. He said, And O Allah, if you do not forgive us, and if you do not bestow your mercy upon us, lanakun. We need Allah's forgiveness and His mercy. Forgiveness alone doesn't work. We also need Allah's mercy. We need it. وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا. What's the result? لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. We are surely, no doubt about it, are going to be from among the losers. That's the result. That's the simple result of anyone who doesn't earn Allah's forgiveness and mercy. Subhanallah. Because if you're forgiven, yes, okay, let's say you're forgiven, and you have absolutely no sin to your name. Are your hasanat enough to admit you to paradise? No. Not even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in the authentic hadith that none of you would enter the paradise because of your good deeds. They said to him, even you, Ya Rasulullah. He said, even me. He said, إِلَّا أَن يَتَغَمَّدَنِ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَتِهِ. Except if Allah Azza wa Jal was to encompass me with His mercy. So Adam alayhi salam is saying, Adam and Hawa, both of them, if you do not forgive us. Yes, and if Allah forgave them, then they're clean from their sins. But then you need Allah's mercy to enter the paradise. وَتَرْحَمْنَا. And if you do not bestow your mercy, لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Will indeed be from among the losers. Subhanallah. And with this we learn that the greatest gift you can earn from Allah Azza wa Jal is His absolute forgiveness upon you, and that He encompasses you and envelops you in His limitless mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the story of Ka'b ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, when he committed a sin, and a major sin, that is that he didn't join the Battle of Tabuk, one of al-jihad, Battle of Tabuk. He didn't go out, laziness, he stayed in al-Madinah. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam punished him and his two other companions in a way where he forbid the entire residents of al-Madinah to speak to them for 50 days. Eventually after that, Allah accepted the tawbah of Ka'b. And then when Allah Azza wa Jal revealed ayat that mentioned to us that Allah Azza wa Jal has forgiven Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, أبشر بخير يوم مر عليك منذ ولدتك أمك. When the ayat of the tawbah, the accepted tawbah of Ka'b came down, and Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم was so excited for him that he went to him and he said to him, أبشر, congratulations يا Ka'b. This today, the day in which Allah accepted your tawbah, is the best day since your mother has given birth to you. Allahu Akbar. You know, the day that you got married, that's not the best day. The day you had your first child, that's not the best day. The day that you graduated, the day that you got your job, the day that you earned $1 million, whatever it is, these are good days. But the best day from when your mother gave birth to you until now is the day that Allah Azza wa Jal forgives you. Is the day Allah Azza wa Jal accepts your tawbah. This is why, in order to achieve this, you need to run after it. Because this is going to be the best day in your life. You know, graduation day. Yeah, when you graduated from school, from your degree, college, whatever it is. Beautiful day. You're wearing that graduation ad, whatever people do, massive party. Look, how long did it take you to get to that day? Oh, my God, how long? And how much effort did you put for it? Like, we're saying that the best and the greatest day in our life is when we earn Allah's forgiveness. So how much preparation should there be for that day? How much preparation and how much effort is required from a believer to achieve the best day in his life, which is the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives him for his sins. Allahu Akbar. فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Subhanallah. And I'm going to end here, my brothers and sisters in Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allow us to walk in the footsteps of Adam alayhi salam concerning the matter of at-tawbah. Concerning Adam alayhi salam being a role model to mankind. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be inspired by His word and to gain as much wisdom and benefit from it. Now that we have this knowledge, my brothers and sisters in Islam, wallahi, it is a responsibility upon each and every single one of us that we deliver it the best we can to those that we love and those that we know and those that we don't know about that need this kind of knowledge, which is all of mankind. And that most importantly, that we implement this knowledge that we know. Now, I just spent with you almost 2 hours, or about an hour and a half, telling you about the plans and the plots of a shaitan and how a shaitan comes to mankind. The responsibility is upon you now that you study this knowledge once again. If you're supposed to listen to this lesson again, listen to it again. Take notes. Understand when the shaitan comes, when you're going into that moment, what do you do? How do you respond? How do you react in that moment? How do you challenge a sin? How do you challenge the evil whispering of a shaitan? How do you do jihad against a shaitan? This is serious stuff. This is every single day we're encountering in our lives. We need to understand this. And we are on earth, here, we're on earth because of that sin. We're on earth because of that sin. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal, in other words, we're still suffering the consequences of that sin until we go back to the paradise. We're still suffering. And everything that comes along with it. This worldly life is a life of trials and tribulations. Allah told Adam alayhi salam, فَلَا يُخْرِجَنَّكُمَا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ فَتَشْقَى. He said to him, don't come near this tree, don't eat from it. Because if you did eat from it, you're going to come down onto a miserable life. You're going to get out of the paradise and come to a miserable life. Yes, we are living in a miserable world. Miserable life. Look how much effort is required from each and every single one of us just to stay on top of things. Just to protect ourselves and to keep away from al-haram and to save, you know, our iman. To keep our iman in store and protected. How much effort is required from us, subhanAllah. For Allah Azza wa Jalla, we're still suffering the consequences of the sin. We're still suffering. إِنَّ لَكَ أَلَّا تَجُوعَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى. Allah said to Adam, in the paradise, you will never go hungry and you will never go naked. So on earth, what does that mean? Means on earth you're going to go hungry. How many people die from poverty every single day? That's a consequence of the sin. How many people? Yes, of course, those that die from poverty and are patient, bi-ithnillah, the highest reward for them in the paradise. فَلَا يُخْرِجَنَّكُمْ إِنَّ لَكَ أَلَّا تَجُوعَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى وَأَلَّا تَظْمَأُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى وَأَنَّكَ لَا تَظْمَأُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى. And in the paradise, you'll never go thirsty and you'll never be hit by the sun. There's no sunstroke there. There's no such thing. That means in this worldly life, you'll go thirsty, you know. And now when we fast and we're thirsty, this is a form of tawbah. We remember our sin. And what brought us here? What brought us on earth? You know, even subhanAllah, that in the paradise, how does one relieve himself? You know, when we go to the bathroom and relieve ourselves, that's the consequence of the first sin which Adam alayhi salam did, and that is that he tasted from the tree. They were still suffering that consequence. How so? Because in the paradise, there's no such thing as relieving yourself via the back passage or the front passage. That doesn't happen. The people of the paradise, how do they relieve themselves? In the hadith it says, "Jushaan ka jushail misk," you burp, and the burp smells like musk. And that's how the believers in the paradise, that's how they relieve themselves. But on earth here, every time you eat and you drink, a few hours, digestive system moving, you need to run to the bathroom. And look at the run to the bathroom. The smells in the bathroom, the waiting lines in the bathroom when you're at public places. What's all that? That's all a consequence of sins. This is why. When we finish from the bathroom, we finish relieving ourselves, we come out, what do we say? What do we say? Who knows? Put it in the comments somewhere so that I can know someone is with me and someone knows what we say when we exit the bathroom. Anyone know what we say? When we leave the bathroom, what do we say? Okay, there it is. Someone said, غُفْرَانَكَ. We say غُفْرَانَكَ when we leave the bathroom. Why do we say that? Have you ever thought of why we say غُفْرَانَكَ when we leave? And what does it mean? غُفْرَانَكَ means, oh Allah, forgive our sins. SubhanAllah. What sins got to do? What does it have to do with when you exit the bathroom? Why do you say that when you leave the bathroom? How is that related? The idea is this. That you're saying, oh Allah, in the same manner, you relieved my internals from the waste that was inside, and if it remained inside, it would have killed me, you know, because if you hold yourself and you don't go to the bathroom, that becomes toxic for the body, it can kill you. Relieving yourself is a blessing. So you remember this, that when you enter the bathroom and you finally relieve yourself and you feel at peace and now you can relax, when you come out of the bathroom, you say غُفْرَانَكَ. In other words, you're saying, oh Allah, also forgive the toxic, poisonous sins that have accumulated on my heart, because they are just as bad as the waste that was inside of me. In other words, if I'm not relieved from my sins, they will stress me out. They will depress me. They will destroy me. Just like waste in the body, if it doesn't come out, it'll destroy me. So we say غُفْرَانَكَ, subhanAllah. And then we remember that what made us relieve ourselves to begin with? Where did all this come from? Because in the paradise, we don't relieve ourselves in this manner. It came after the sin. When Adam ate, from the tree and came on earth. From then onwards, mankind began to relieve himself. So it's a consequence of the sin. So when we leave the bathroom, we say, Ghufranak, O Allah, in the same manner you relieved my body from waste that was about to kill me, relieve my heart and my conscience and my soul from sins, that if they remain on my heart, they will also destroy me spiritually. The other thing would have destroyed you physically, sins would destroy you spiritually. This is it, my brothers and sisters in Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. Jazakum Allahu khayran for your patience with us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal that He allow us to benefit from that which we heard. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in beneficial knowledge, to increase us in sincere action and worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. And we ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala that He bless us with sincerity in each and every single word we speak and in every deed that we do, and we do only for His sake subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakum Allahu khayran jami'an, and يعني أحبكم في الله jami'an, as a response to all your dua. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gather us all in a much better place than this world, and that is the paradise. Hold on, my brothers and sisters in Islam, to your faith. Be patient with it. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. You see Allah's love for us. Allah's love for us is telling us, hold on to your taqwa, and do not die except in a state of submission to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Don't die. Don't leave this world except that you're a Muslim. And in order to have ease in doing so, you need to hold on to it from now. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to keep Islam within us, to keep Iman within us. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us patience upon our worship, upon our Islam, upon our Iman, until the day we meet Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.